If you'll remember the statement that I made, I said that God has set up in his plan and in his will the ability for a man who is humble and has a contrite heart to hear the gospel and to believe the gospel. So I want to go over that. I want to cover that in just a little more detail and give you some scripture behind that. I stated it in passing in the last video, and now I want to give you the verses, and these verses are going to lay the groundwork for how the gospel works and how it operates. So if you go back to Psalm chapter 34 and verse 18, it says, "The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit." Now, so he says that he saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. It is the will of God that men be trained, that men be subjected to disciplines, to punishments. That's his will and his plan in order to have a child grow up into a man that is no longer a child who doesn't know his left hand from his right, but to grow into a man that is able to respond to the gospel when it is properly presented to him. So it's the emphasis of the book of Proverbs. Instill in your children discipline. Instill in your children discipline. The blueness of the wound will drive away wickedness. It'll drive away sin. It'll drive away wickedness. It will teach him how to respond to correction. It'll teach him to respond to things from a position of humility instead of a position of pride. And so that's the emphasis of the book of Proverbs itself. The Bible says in Psalm chapter 51, verse 17, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise." So the Lord loves humility. When we were talking about the examples in the Bible of God responding to men who were contrite and humble, we used the centurion in the book of Acts. And we could have also talked about, because we were discussing at the same time, the level of depravity that a man can reach. And we were talking about some of those things. The Bible says, "These six things doth the Lord hate." So there are six things that are definitely terrible things and represent a deeper level of depravity than some other men may be. "Yea, seven are an abomination unto him." And the top of the list was a proud look. It's a proud look. And so pride is going to lift a man and elevate a man to a place where the more proud he is, the harder it is to get him to a position of humility so that he can accept the Lord. You remember in Acts chapter 13, there were some men who were interested in running Paul out of town, and there were some men interested in hearing what Paul had to say. And so those men ended up getting saved. So Isaiah chapter 57 and verse 15 says, "For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite one." So you see again, that's God's will to deliver the humble people. Isaiah 66 verse 2, "For all those things hath mine hand made, and all those things have been, saith the Lord, but to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit and trembleth at my word. As many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God." Trembles at the word of God. They believe because their humility allows them to elevate the Lord up above themselves. John the Baptist preached the same thing when he said, "He must increase and I must decrease." So even in this world, there are people who are contrite, and then there are people who are hard-hearted. But yet in the Bible, we see that even the hard-hearted have a chance because of the sovereignty of God present in the gospel. Now, the Bible says in John chapter 16, speaking about the Holy Spirit, he said, "When he has come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment." The Spirit's job is to come and convince the world of these things. Now, the Bible says also that that job of the Holy Spirit is also the mandate of the preacher. Titus 1:9, holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and convince the gainsayer. The gainsayer is that proud man who wants his own way, who believes his own way. Paul says you're supposed to hold fast the faithful word just like you've been taught. And he said you're going to preach sound doctrine and it can convince the gainsayer. So change the mind, convince the gainsayer, change the mind. That's what repentance is. Change the mind of the hard-minded man. And so you see the sovereignty, the power, the strength, the will of God is in the process. The continuity of the mission between the Holy Spirit and man is definitely seen. It's the Holy Spirit's job to draw men, to convince men, to teach men. It's also the job of the preacher. So there's a congruency there. There's a continuity of mission between the Holy Spirit and the preacher. That's because, and you can even say the gospel witness, because the power of God is in the gospel. The Holy Spirit and man both have the same mandate to convince the gainsayer, to convince the humble, but also to convince those who don't believe. Matthew chapter 21, verse 28 through 31. But what think ye? A certain man had two sons, and he came to the first and said, Son, go work today in my vineyard. He answered and said, I will not. But afterwards he repented and went. He repented and went. And he came to the second and said likewise, and he answered and said, I go, sir, and went not. Whether of them twain did the will of his father? Now, Calvinism says you don't have the ability to do the will. So he said, which of them twain did the will of his father? They say unto him, the first. Jesus saith unto them, verily I say unto you, that the publicans and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. So in that same sense, in that same regard, Jesus says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power. See those three words? To them gave he power to become the sons of God. Now look very carefully at that. We often talk about received him or become the sons of God. But look at those three words. Gave he power. The sovereignty of God is in the process. Gave he power to become the sons of God. So the power is given to the preacher. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Tarry at Jerusalem. And he said, until ye be endued with power. He said, tarry at Jerusalem. And he said, when the power of God comes, when the Holy Spirit of God, who has this mandate to convince, he said, when the Holy Spirit of God comes to you, he said, then you're going to be witnesses unto me. So the fact that I have the mandate to preach, the fact that I have the Holy Spirit, the comforter, the teacher, the reprover, the judge, because I have him in my heart, I have the ability, I have the authority of God, the sovereignty of God within me to fulfill the desire of God, which is to draw all men to himself. And so as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. So the power is given to the preacher, Acts chapter 1, verse number 8, and then the power is given to the new believer who receives the message delivered by the preacher to become the sons of God. So he says, as to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born. Notice, it does not say which were born again. It says these people were born, not of the blood. The Bible says the life of the flesh is in the blood, but the blood doesn't. Those chemicals, whatever it may be in the blood that helps us to live, those chemicals can't get together in an evolutionary process and produce life, but it was given by the will of God. Life was given by the will of God. He said, which were born not of blood, not of chemical makeup, nor of the will of the flesh. Two parents can't get together and decide, hey, we're going to have children. It's not possible. Even though we have all the anatomical abilities to produce children. Children come from God. You see that in Old Testament characters. The mother of the prophet Samuel, she was barren until God gave her the ability to bring forth a child. So it says, not of the blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So God gave us life, and so when God gave us life, man rejected the will of God, man rejected the commandments of God, did his own thing. And so now the first birth is it's corrupt. And so the Bible says we must be born again. And so notice this, he didn't say, it's talking about being born again by the will of God. It's God's will that every man be born again. How do we know this? Because God said, whosoever will, let him come. And so the power is given to the preacher, and the power is given to the new believer if he believes, if he is humble enough to concede the merits of Christ above his own merits, then he can accept the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. And that leads us into this verse of Scripture in John chapter 6 that says, no man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. That verse represents the sovereignty of God, and that's where we'll begin our next video. Thank you for watching.